imagine.
Joel, is he a suspect in that?
Well, he's not officially a suspect, even though I think clearly, you know, he's, the way they're treating it, he clearly is a suspect, even though they haven't announced it. The problem we have, and I requested this both from Dr. Bodden, who did the private autopsy, and from the Illinois State Police, is to release those two autopsies to us so that we can compare it with the first autopsy and see what the discrepancies are, because that's how you figure out where the problems are, and they won't do it. So we're at a loss.
If a woman before her death warned someone very close to her that she could die and it could be made to look like an accident by her husband, and then 4 years later, what was thought to be an accident turns out to be a homicide.
Well, that's assuming that the second coroner's report is correct. We have two conflicting coroner's reports, only one of which has been released, and the only one that's been released is the one that says it's an accident. So, you know, when you have conflicting reports, the idea is you release both of them, and then you get peer review from other pathologists and see why they're conflicting, and we can't do that yet.
Neighbors saying that there was a barrel. One neighbor saying that they saw Peterson and some other guy moving a blue barrel around the time that Stacy might have gone missing.
Yeah, I put absolutely no credence, no credibility in that statement. To say that there's a neighbor that saw something when the media has been camped out in front of Drew's house now for 4 weeks, that neighbor wouldn't have, and they've been interviewing his neighbors, you know, probably every neighbor's been interviewed.
But Joel, this was hours after, this is an allegation that this witness saw this hours after she went missing. The media wasn't there hours after she went missing.
No, but the witness should have come forward by now, you know, 4 weeks, and we still don't have a name or identity to this witness.
First of all, let's talk about the pastor.
Okay.
Now, so far, anytime anyone's come out and said anything that is potentially incriminating to your client, they've been described as liars or hypocrites or something else. Well, are you going after the man of the cloth, too?
No, but when you look at what he says, what he did, he says that Stacy talked to a pastor and said that she feared, you know, bodily harm. But they didn't obviously think it was very serious because they didn't report this to the authorities. They made a judgment call, they say, and they didn't think it was serious enough to report it. So they really must not have been a very emphatic plea or an emphatic charge by.
Right. He is saying straight out, Stacy said he killed third wife. You gonna go after the man of the cloth now?
Well, I got to go after his story because it really doesn't make sense. You have to remember, this guy is a certified marriage counselor. In Illinois, he knows he's what they call a mandated reporter. He has to report these type of things. He's saying that Stacy came to him and said, "My husband murdered his former wife. I'm living with him. I'm in fear of my life." And the pastor says, "Okay, that's nice. Go home and pray."
Did he say that she was saying that she was in fear for her own life?
Absolutely.
Mr. Brodsky, thank you so much for joining us. Of course, you are the defense attorney in Chicago, Illinois, for Drew Peterson. First of all, when did you find out that Drew's mother and stepfather were going to have to testify before the grand jury?
Drew called me a few days ago about that. He was upset, concerned. Says his mother really has a slight touch of Alzheimer's, that she doesn't remember so well, and he was a little bit concerned about her, you know, her memory and what the stress this might put her under. But like you said, after she came out and seemed to be in good spirits, he was relieved.
I want to first go out to Joel Brodsky. He is the defense attorney for Drew Peterson, now a suspect in his fourth wife's disappearance, especially after the dry bathtub drowning death of his third wife was ruled homicide. Joel, welcome. You're a veteran trial lawyer in your jurisdiction of Chicago. I'm just wondering why your client keeps saying over and over that it's a waste of the searcher's time and energy to look for his wife.
He says, or he knows, that Stacy called him the night she left and told him she was leaving. So with this knowledge that he has, he knows that they're not going to find her in some bush or some pond or stream in Bolingbrook.
There is the dichotomy. In fact, your client actually stated that he can't bear to clean out Stacy's clothes from their bedroom closet.
That's true. You know, there's certainly two different Drew Petersons that are being portrayed.
Live from the heart of New York City, it's The Morning Show with Mike and Juliet.
Can you, do you want to comment on any of those things, like the blue barrel, for instance?
Okay, well, start with the blue barrel.
Okay.
There never was a blue barrel. I think the first mention of a blue barrel was when Stacy's sister said that Drew had a 55-gallon drum of chlorine that he used for the pool. Well, that's ridiculous. He has a very small, like 3-foot-deep, above-ground pool in his backyard. A 55-gallon drum of chlorine would last a century.